So today I'm going to go over an actual comic page. The last time I talked to you guys about comics, we did the cover of chapter 6 together. Now we're doing page 1 together. The difference, there isn't much of a difference between the two, just that this one has a little bit more going on. So I'm going to go over a couple of the panels with you, and then I will probably either end the video or just work to music. I haven't decided yet. It really depends on how chatty I get. So here is the scrap paper I was telling you guys about. I had misprinted one of my chapters, so now I'm using it as scratch paper rather than throw it away. So with pages that have multiple panels, you're going to be taping off around the individual panels that you need to do perspective grids for. And you're doing that partially to give yourself more room to work, because that's kind of a small space, but you're also doing it to protect those other panels so they're not covered in lines that have nothing to do with them. And you might think, well, I can just erase those lines. It'll take less time than taping down a bunch of pieces of paper. And that might be so. But for me, I would rather work this way because, you know, there's always the chance that I'm not going to be able to get all of the lines up. And I hate erasing. If I can skip erasing, I'll skip erasing. So I'm going to finish putting surrounding this panel, and I'll get back to you guys. So in this panel, which is Kara stretching in her tiny person bedroom, we're going to have a high horizon line. So I'm probably going to need to tape a couple of additional sheets of paper up here to give me room to work. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Okay, so now we have our paper in place. And you can kind of gauge where the horizon line should be just by extending one of the lines in your sketch and seeing where it falls. And just like with the other pages, I'm going to use a Color Eno soft blue mechanical pencil filled with Color Eno soft blue lead. And you can find, I'll probably put a card linking to where you can buy that. And hopefully I'll remember to put a link in the description below. But I get mine off of Amazon these days. And you might be thinking at this point, that sure looks like it's a lot of effort just to make a comic. And you would be thinking, correct, it is a lot of effort to make a comic. It's a lot of effort. But it's a labor of love. And if you happen to want to support my labor of love, you can find it at natosoup.com/products, and that's where volume 1 of this comic is. This is the second chapter for the second volume. Okay, so I've already established one vanishing point way over here, almost at the end of that taped on sheet of paper. And I'm about to find my other vanishing point, which is much closer, thankfully. So we've got our horizon line and our two vanishing points. So just like last time, and I'll try to move the camera closer so you guys can see a little bit better. We're going to start drawing lines radiating from those two vanishing points to set up a perspective grid in our panel. Working on a glass top desk causes my blue lead to shatter. So if you have a craft mat, that might help protect your leads and keep them from shattering. And with little panels like this, I actually like to extend my grid just a little bit. Yeah, you guys are going to be hearing that clicking lead extension noise a lot, I'm afraid. So we've got about half of our grid drawn now. Now it's time to do the annoying far away vanishing point. And I'll try to keep things on camera as much as I can. Oh, see, my ruler got away from me, so you gotta be careful about that, because if your ruler slides, it's going to affect your grid. It's gonna make it inaccurate. So if you catch it sliding, you need to... Man, working on a glass top desk just burns through lead. That's what the container looks like. Wow. Alright, now I gotta pause the video. So, might as well demonstrate this pencil. It's pretty straightforward. I usually like to put two leads in it, and it feeds from the back, so you take out the eraser, which I pretty much never use. I just grab, like, a full-size eraser rather than these stupid little bump-bump erasers. And then you just click the back until it comes out. Pretty straightforward. Not the sturdiest pencil, but it's affordable and it's a lot easier on my hand than my drafting pencil, which kind of tears my hand up. So now we have a perspective grid for this teeny tiny drawing of Kara stretching in her teeny tiny bedroom in the morning. It's a lot of work for one panel, but I think it's worth it because your illustration just looks more, I don't want to say realistic because I have a really cartoony style, but it looks more, it just feels right, you know? So I'm going to go ahead and draw Kara in because I'm going to scale everything around her. That's usually what I do, is I try to scale things around the tallest figure or the most important figure in the illustration. And if you are learning how to do perspective, or you'd like to learn how to do it by hand and want to do things more complicated than this, there are several really great books and resources out there. I originally started with one of Andrew Loomis's works. He has several, he's since passed away, but his books have recently re-entered print. So that's funny collection of tenses. He has, there is a book by Andrew Loomis out about drawing things in perspective, and I'm pretty sure the title is something just like drawing things in perspective. I'll link to it in the description though, so you guys can find it. And that does a pretty comprehensive introduction to perspective, drawing things in perspective, breaking things down so that you can understand how they would be drawn in perspective. And I'm having a tired recovering from being sick night tonight, so I can't quite remember the other books, but I'll link them below if you're looking for help. And I'm sure there are plenty of fantastic tutorials online. I learned from books. I kind of treated them like workbooks, and I did one exercise at a time. If you learn better that way, then those books will be great for you. And if you learn better from online resources, then you could probably just Google how to draw perspective, and that would probably give you a good start. So at this scale, and I'm drawing at 8.5 by 11 paper on a 9-inch by 6-inch page, so Kara is like maybe 2 inches, it's still important to try and capture as much detail as you can. As much detail as looks appropriate. So that's another thing that, sadly, you're just going to have to put the time in and go draw from life to decide what looks right to you. And now I'm drawing her pet house gecko asleep in the top of a lip balm tin. Oh, this lead keeps shattering inside the pencil. I really need to find, if I'm going to be drawing on a glass top desk, I really need to find a pencil that isn't going to, that's going to have more of like a spring action in it, because this one has like none, so the lead shatters pretty easily, and this is really soft lead. Now I'm sketching in her bed, which is a sponge that's been covered in a handkerchief with a homemade quilt. And she kind of has, since she's a little girl, she kind of has this cute draped canopy above her bed, but you're not gonna be able to see all of that. It's shown in other illustrations, so it's not a huge loss. This panel is actually a pretty easy panel to do. And here are her curtains. And here's the baseboard right by her bed. And don't get discouraged if it takes you a lot longer to do this kind of thing. It's just all practice. So here is where the sun is. More like over here. Where the sun is shining through the window, and you can see really gotta find a better pencil. So the only real issue about taping over your paper like this is you can't see the panel prior if you need to reference it. So you have to like haul a bunch of paper out of your way to do that. All right, so I've got most of the basics in. I know where everything is. So I can start tightening this up with my pencil. And one of the things I wanted to do is I had left the top of the panel border unpenciled until I knew where her hand was gonna hit. So I can fill that in with this tiny little ruler. And I'm making a conscious choice to have her stretch break the panel border because it kind of accentuates the movement of the stretch. The energy of the stretch. And I apologize if I end up, or that I was so far off camera. I mean, you could still see what I was doing, but I'm like way off to the side. And you're pretty much going to be repeating these steps for every page that has, that needs perspective, that has a significant background. And it's not hard, it's just kind of tedious. Which is why a lot of people are switching over to programs like Manga Studio, or they're setting up grids in Photoshop, because it doesn't require as much manual effort. But this was the method I was taught while I was at SCAD, so it's kind of the one that stuck with me the longest. It's the one I always, like, I've done it so much I could think I could do it in my sleep. I used to when I was in in grad school, I would have dreams about laying out comic perspective, and I'd wake up and know how I was gonna lay out the panel or lay out the page, so my brain wanted to get that work done. You guys don't know how disappointing it is to spend your whole night dreaming that you got your work done and wake up to find out you don't have anything done. At least you have a solution, though. It's very frustrating. I'm pretty sure her bedroom has some stamps as, like, pictures. I'm gonna have to go pull out volume one in a second to make sure I get those in there. Because now is the easiest time to put that in, because I have the perspective grids. I can see where everything is. So I guess I'll go do that. Okay, so this is volume one. This is my copy of volume one. I bring them all to cons, or I bring a lot of them to cons with me, but this is like my beaten up, has seen many shows, has my mailing address in it. So in case someone steals my book again, which has happened, they can at least feel guilty. So this is her bedroom as seen in chapter two. And it looks like she has a stamp over her bed. Sorry, I was supposed to be like, that's cute. My own work is cute. So I need to draw the stamp over her bed. And she also has, but it's probably not visible in this illustration, she also has a nail where she likes to hang her bed. And her curtains have a tie with a bead on them. So it's a good thing I checked. And honestly, now that I have a print copy of my book, or many print copies of my book, it's actually really handy to be able to check it rather than like rifling through my original pages. So if you're doing this for a webcomic, the solution to that is just check your archives. It's kind of a shame though, I didn't put any pictures over there. Oh, and now you guys can't see what I'm doing. Boop, 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 boop. Now you can. And I need to draw the tie on her curtains. Consistency is important. Otherwise, I would add some drawings over there. I mean, if this was like more than just a couple of weeks, let's say a season passed by, I'd probably put some stuff over there, just because that's how kids, you know, that's how people in general decorate their rooms. Your room will change over time. You're going to put up posters and drawings and stuff. Heck, even if 2 weeks passes by, for me, I'm putting up new art, but, you know, I don't want to confuse my readers either. Maybe, because Kara likes to draw, so maybe a bark drawing on, like, paper bark with charcoal of Dusty, her lizard. So since she's 10 and she's drawing with charcoal, I'm gonna like really rough it in. And maybe even draw like Kara's handprint over here. And a thumb tack to tack it up. So there. If anybody calls me out on being inconsistent, you guys heard me rationalize it, heard me explain it. Y'all are my witnesses. And those are little like tufts of yarn, because sometimes they have that on hand-sewn blankets. They're usually much smaller, but that's because the blanket is much bigger. And there is one house gecko asleep in his bed. Not ready to be awake. I have a pet leopard gecko. I have had leopard geckos as pets since I was 14. So that's who Dusty's kind of based off of. Also, my mom's house in Louisiana always gets these big fat house geckos outside the windows. So, and since this is set in Louisiana, I thought it was a good combination. So, if you happen to like geckos, you might happen to like my comic. And that's the baseboard. I need to move my cup-o drawing things. Getting him away. And that's gonna be the sun shining through her window. That perspective is wrong. So this is gonna be brown floor, but this is gonna be a lighter shade of the floor because the sun's coming in and affecting that light. And this is a watercolor comic, so I can do it and it will be recognizable. Now I need to double check and make sure I know which way the slats in her bedroom are going. Apparently I just did dark brown floor. I think for a panel this size I can probably get away with that too. So that's just one panel of many on this page. The next step is to remove all of the paper and the tape, because you're going to reuse the paper until it is falling apart and can't be used. Fortunately, the tape doesn't work so well on the second go round. I've actually been wanting to do a series of posts about this for years, and what's always, I'll start, but it is so much more additional work to write a post rather than to record a post on this topic. Like, just so, it makes making a comic take so much longer that I usually just abandon it and, say next time I do a chapter, I'll do a post on it. And now I'm finally doing it, so. My next panel is kind of a cheaty panel because there isn't any perspective on it. It's Kara in silhouette running down the stairs, and it's like 1-point perspective, which means like a flat horizon line, everything goes to that. But since it's in silhouette and very flat, I don't even necessarily have to do that. So really, on this page, this is going to require some guidelines, but I'm not going to do a grid for this. But this one is going to require, I think I'm going to do a grid for that one. So hopefully we can knock out the next two panels really quick, and you guys will have a pretty good idea of how I do a page. And I think the next time I'm going to check in with you guys is when I, when I'm doing the double page spread that's in this chapter. Since that was something that before I'd ever done a double page spread, I had questions about, and I'll show you guys how I go about getting one roughed. And then after that, I think we're just going to talk about printing blue lines, and I'll do a few videos about painting. Actually, there's a lot left now that I'm thinking about it. And scanning is like a really important one, because it's scanning watercolors, so you want to be color accurate. And I have some tricks for that too. But we're not even on this step, or that step. We are still roughing those pages out. As always, if my videos help you do something, I would really love it if you link me to the thing you make so I can check it out. I personally feel like artists who have been taught by others, and that's every artist, right? We kind of like need to pay it forward and teach a new generation. So I would love to see what you guys do. And signal boost it, because, you know, community support is really important. I ask you guys to support me, so of course I'm going to do my bit to support you guys when I can. I can't always financially afford to, but I can certainly afford to, like, tweet your comic so other people can see it, or tweet your YouTube channel, or, you know. I really think I can just, like, pull her whole body up. So I'm going to do that, because really all you need to see for this gesture is honestly the legs. Maybe the very bottom of her torso, because I feel like I haven't left enough room in this rough illustration. And the hard one is the back one, because the way stairs go, your knee is actually going to be kind of close. Like, that just feels so weird. And I want the front one lower, so it looks like she's actually going to connect with the stair. I was when I was doing the rust for this chapter, I was at a coffee house, and I had to look up people falling downstairs, because in the next panel she trips because she's running down the stairs, and I felt like such a jerk googling person falling downstairs, person stumbling downstairs, but I don't personally want to take a dive down the stairs, so I have fallen down the stairs a few times in my apartment, and I hate it. So I'm not going to volunteer myself for that if someone else has posted. What I was really hoping for, because at first I looked up, like, animated person stumbling downstairs. I was really hoping for, like, a step-by-step for how to animate that, and that's not what I found. I found pictures of people. Did you know that's like a thing people are into, watching other people fall downstairs and get hurt? What kind of monster do you have to be? Maybe I'm the monster because I think that's just like a horrible thing to enjoy watching. I felt bad just Googling for it. My head's getting into the shot again, so I'm gonna be careful. See, I tried to make the stairs taller, and now they're just gonna like intersect your body. Because I was thinking how shallow the stairs look in my sketch. There's a correct way to do stairs. I'm being kind of lazy, which is bad because I'm demonstrating being lazy to you guys, and that's not what I want you guys to learn. So we're gonna do it a little more proper. Which means the stairs will probably disappear from view at one point. Drawing over tape is the worst. And I'm also gonna have to erase where. Yeah, those stairs are gonna disappear from view. Just gonna fudge the heck out of these stairs. Gonna have to redraw that when I pull up the tape. And then there's the railing. And see, you would normally want to just like slide your ruler, but the tape keep is pulling up and catching it. So if you can, you can, and if you can't, well, you're just gonna have to make accommodations. And they do make sliding rulers. I find those get away from me. You know, I really want that railing higher up. I'll do it up here. Because I moved her body up a whole lot. So that should hit correct. That should be right. That's another thing I'm going to have to check, is what kind of designs I put on the railing. I think only the bottom one has any sort of an intricate design. I think the rest of them are just, oh yeah, and one of them is gonna be broken. I should make it this one. This one's the broken one. Further in the chapter, I think. Nope, it looks like they are plain all the way down. Let's double check against chapter one. There, now it's like you've read the book. What I'm going to do is extend this railing up so I can draw my lines correctly. So see, even when you're not doing perspective grids, laying down additional sheets of paper to give you more work area without it going into the next panel is really helpful. And you're not going to need it for every panel, but the more often you make comics, the more you're going to know what you need and what you can kind of skip. This is the broken one. This is the... So now we've got pretty much everything roughed in. I can start drawing the actual content. So I'm gonna do that and I'll get back to you guys. All right, so here is that panel penciled in. And as always, you guys seem to catch me when it's time to remove the paper. Hopefully I can do that a little more quickly, since it's just three sheets. And that's gonna leave us with two panels, and with me having to fill in some of the panel that was covered up by tape. So I'll do that real quick. A lot of my comic process is actually just taping stuff down and removing tape, which can be kind of boring, but you know, usually I don't have people watch me either. I mean, they can if they want, but I usually am pretty private about my comics. So I'm gonna get this taped up and we'll get to work on this panel. Alright, so this is another panel on this page that doesn't necessarily require me to lay out a grid, but it does require me to use a ruler and make sure my lines look right and my spacing is correct. And in this panel, Kara's tripping on the stairs, so her foot is going to be breaking the panel, and the panel is going to be kind of catawampus, kind of imply that her foot has gone through. And I'm just using a little ruler to help mark a straight line for each of the stairs. And she's actually wearing shoes in this panel, but I have her drawn barefoot, so I'm gonna have to draw in her shoes. But this is a pretty easy panel. Although this ruler is not a pretty easy panel to do lines with. It's a cutting ruler, not a drawing ruler. And her wearing a shoe actually makes it a lot easier for me. So the shoe has ties on it, and I'm drawing them kind of up and going in different directions to continue to push that movement. And I could actually remove these sheets and continue the skewed panel border, which I'll do right now, because that's going to help. Oh no, I guess it does go all the way up. All right, wow. That's going to help push this impression that she's falling, the skewed panel border. At least I think it will. And I'm also going to have to use maybe different colors or jarring colors to indicate danger or negative surprise when I... So maybe like orange in the border. And I could even invert the colors of the stairs and her foot. And I could do that traditionally in watercolor, or I could paint it as I would and then invert it in Photoshop. Since these are handmade shoes, I'm just going to draw little stitches on the bottom to show that somebody had sewn it. And I'm going to pull my... Actually, I'm going to use this ruler because the other ruler is a little weird. I'm going to draw the stairs in. And see, my ruler slipped. So now we just have one panel left, and I think that panel is going to be in one-point perspective, which is kind of cheating. That doesn't really happen too often in real life. But it's also the perspective grid I haven't, or one of the perspective grids I haven't gone over with you guys yet. So I'm going to get this taped off and I'll get back to you. All right, so we're on our last panel. And like I discussed with you guys, I think it's going to be a one-point perspective. And those are really easy to do. So you draw your horizon line. And it should be at eye level, usually, with a one-point. And then you find the middle of your panel. And then you draw lines radiating from the middle of your panel. Unless you're me and you miss the middle entirely. Now, the way this works is that lines that go up and down are going to continue to be straight, and lines that would otherwise go to a vanishing point are also going to be parallel to your horizon line. The lines that are going to go to your vanishing point are like this one in the corner, which pretty much would follow that line directly. I mean, this is seriously the easiest perspective you can do. And while you're learning, it's very tempting to pretty much do nothing but one-point perspective because it doesn't get the job done well, but it gets the job done, and it gives the impression of, you know, you did take time to figure out perspective. And if you're working on a really tight schedule, like you only have time to work on your comic in between classes or as when you get home from work and you're tired, one point is probably better than no comic at all. But if you're actively trying to improve your comic skills, one point should not be the perspective you reach for. Drafting table seriously eats my lead. And you know how I had mentioned in the prior, in an earlier panel, that I draw the most, I usually will draw the tallest person in the panel first, and then base everyone off of where they hit? Well, this is Kara's mom, and she's the tallest person. The person I'm drawing now is Kara's mom, and she's the tallest person in the panel. And see, even one point perspective has more depth to it than that flat silhouette panel I just showed you guys. And I have some reference I need to pull up that I took when I was in Louisiana, so you guys will have to excuse me if I get quiet for a minute because I'm trying to find it. See, the problem with this, the way I drew this, is Kara would be taller than her mom. So that means I have to start. Oh, man. Start again. At least with her. And what I'm gonna hate the most is placing the legs around the stairs, because they really complicate things. But I think I've pretty much got it. And put that to the side. And pull out this other reference I have of her stairwell, because I want to stay consistent. See if I can find it. And this is totally not an excuse just to show off book one. I think I passed it up. Might actually be in the start of book two, so I might have to go actually pull out other pages. Yeah. I think it is in book two. Support beam there, and then it would go up to match the rise of the stairs. And I have to look up what her mom's outfit looks like for this page. And then we start penciling. So I'm going to check in with you guys after I've penciled this and after I've untaped it, so you can see the whole page as it looks together. And so I can tell you guys goodbye. All right. So this is the whole page when the taped off pieces are removed. And something that can happen when you're doing that is you can, because you're only working on small sections, you can end up with tangents that are confusing to your viewer. So Even though this rough is done for me right now, I'm going to be sending it and all of the other pages in the chapter when they're completed to other people to beta read for me. Because they'll hopefully be able to point out things that I am just, like, too familiar with the pages to have noticed. From where I am right now, I can't see any obvious tangents, but that's a good cause to have somebody else with fresh eyes take a look at it. So, that was how I break down a multiple panel page. I'm Becca Hilburn. I hope you guys found this useful and informative. If you have any questions, please leave me a comment below. If you found this useful or helpful or interesting in any way, please consider sharing it with your friends, hitting like, hitting subscribe, and checking out my blog, nattosoup.blogspot.com. Have a good evening, guys. Bye.